Planet's wonderful mission. I'd like to give you a little bit of history about the Kepler mission. When I was first imagining it, and I was hoping that we might be able to do, at that time, we're now known exoplanets, but if NASA was to explore the galaxy, we'd have to find out whether there were planets, whether there were Earth-sized planets. So that was one of the things that, in some sense, gave rise to the mission. And of course, one always needs to think about the future, including what one of the mission that would give us the statistics that would allow us to move on to more powerful missions. At the bottom there, you can see a few of the many organizations that contributed substantially to the mission. We have the Ames Research Center, Ball Aerospace, GPL, the last Lawrence Hall of Science and Southern Astrophysical Observatory, SETI, and Space Telescope Science Institute. And that's just a few of the many organizations that made this mission possible. What I'd like to do then is give you a little bit of background history. I like to think of the concept of the mission sort of starting with a paper by Frank Rosenblatt. He was an AI researcher and wrote a paper in 1971 talking about how you might use photometry to find planets. He died shortly thereafter, unfortunately. But his paper was the first quantitative discussion how one might do this. He had some ideas about colors, in fact. Difficulty people saw in the original paper was that needed to invent a photometer that was 100 to 1,000 times better than anything people had invented or had built before. And that was somewhat discouraging to some people. I had worked on the Apollo program, and I knew that with enough effort and a new technology, we ought to be able to build such a photometer. So I funded from NASA in 1983. Wrote my first paper with Audrey Summers in 1984 talking about the fact that you might be able to find Jovian-sized planets from the Earth's surface, but you really need to go out into space to find small planets like Earth. The following year, I wrote a paper with Jeff Scargill and Andrew Hudson. We talked about the fact that even though you could build a nearly perfect photometer, the big limit was really going to be the variability of the stars themselves. We felt that all stars would be so variable they would have a substantial impact on our ability to find small planets. After that, I spent some time using different photometers at observatories. I worked with the ISP to build some prototype photometers. We held three workshops talking about how to build photometers that can do the 10 parts per million photometry that is required. I also advocated the system to others, and the science community generally is pretty negative about this business. Now basically, the Space Science Board report that it really wasn't likely to work. And in fact, they said clear identification by this technique appears unlikely. So we were very poorly funded during this time, and we had to go through quite a few steps before we convinced the community this was going to work. In 1992, the Discovery Program opened up so we could propose concepts. We proposed the freesome concept, which was the precursor to Kepler, and people said, well, it's a great idea, but there are no detectors that can do the 10 part per million photometry that you're demanding. Our response to that, of course, was to show that CCDs would do that as long as you measured their systematic errors and corrected that. In 1994, we had another opportunity to propose. In that case, the proposal was rejected, and they said, you've got to put a space telescope. Space telescopes cost billions of dollars. There's no way you can stay within budget. We proposed in 1996, and the proposal was rejected then as well. They said, oh, they've done the property of thousands of stars simultaneously, an automatic analysis. Basically, the way you do it is you look at one star at a time, compare your target star with a comparison star, and comparison star with a standard star, and you do that for the Earth's atmosphere. You do the analysis by hand. And so we were setting to do 10,000 at a time or more, and we would do by analysis by computer. So they said, well, in that case, build an observatory and show us it can be done. That's what occurred in over 2 years with no funds. But the aim gave us a charge card that we could charge up to $3,000 on our charge card. And so we go to the observatory. By going to the lit observatory, talking to their astronomers, asking them, do you have an old dome that we can use? The answer is sure. We've got one that was donated in 1870. It hasn't been used a lot in the last century. So there was our observatory. All we had to do was build the telescope. 1995, of course, was a wonderful year, and the first exoplanet was found around a normal star. Previously, of course, we had Wolfson find one around a neutron star. 1998, we proposed again, and what they said was, you've shown us technical work, you can do automated photometry, but you have to build a facility that shows you can do 10 part per million photometry with realistic noise that you would have on orbit, such as jiggling the spacecraft would have, and jiggling moves the images across the CC and introduces a lot of noise. We proposed 2000, that proposal was accepted in 2001, so NASA approved the Kepler mission for development. It was also the first year that people using transit photography from the ground found the planet, in this case, a Jovian-sized planet with a short period where that, I believe, was on the first radar velocity. But it was showing there were planets to find, and that was a huge help to the mission development. So here, early photographers, I talked about where we were trying to build simple systems. On the left-hand side, something built for ready. And IST, at that time, called measurement standards, it was something that we were talking about quantum particle detectors, which in this case were really Yamamatsu, nearly perfect crystal silicon crystals. It showed that we indeed could go to a very high precision, highest precision that we could measure with our meters. The next thing, of course, is to take that silicon detectors, put it in that plate in the center figure. That's a 17-inch square plate, a bunch of holes drilled into it. You put the detectors there, and you can monitor a group of bright stars. That got down to the scintillation limit of the atmosphere, but of course that's nowhere near 10 parts per million. And we could only do bright stars with low temperature silicon diodes. So on the right-hand side there you see a viewer. We put the detectors in the viewer, coupled with optical fibers, and it was the worst photometer I've ever built. It was a probe failure. And what we found, of course, was when you couple something with optical fibers, you're basically exciting various modes. Any movement of that fiber changes the number of modes that are excited, the amount of light that goes through those fibers. So that was something that was basically, we had to rely on. On the right hand side are some measurements by Larry Robinson and our team, where we took an old CCD. Yeah, we didn't have money to buy a CCD or its electronics. So this is a rejected CCD that's front side illuminated and takes 15 minutes to read out. But we were able to show that indeed that system is beginning to work, or 11.4 million. They're showing that even with a poor CCD, once you measure this, the systematic errors and correct for them, you do get the precision you need. Those are the results of the observation. Need to go on. The next thing we had to do, of course, was show that we could do automated photometry. This is at the 1870 dome, and the little telescope that we built there appeared. The telescope, of course, uses World War II and reconnaissance lens because that's what we could afford. On the right hand side is the data showing that we could see the transit of HD209.58. That's an air mass 4. So it was pretty clear you come to Grand Canton, Jovian satellite. And the radio signals from this telescope to Ames were reduced by automated photometry. So we were able to demonstrate you can do large number of stars in an automated fashion. Next thing we had to do, of course, was show that we could do 10 part per million in a test facility with the kind of noise that we would see on orbit. The object up to your left is a booth that has the instrument in it. At the bottom is a light scattering sphere. The light goes through a plate with lots of laser field holes that represent stars. It comes up to a CCD that is held in some right positioners that jiggle with the right power spectrum. The entire facility there is about the size of Doctor Who's phone booth, about 3 meters high, 2 meters across. On the right is some of the data that we got. It was very easy to show for 92 stars, and the synchrotrons were pretty readily found. By the time you go to 12 magnitude stars, the shot noise is going up. You really wanted to see more than one transit if you're going to say we're finding planets, small planets. In any case, I did show, again, we could handle that with the kind of motions that we expect with gamma rays and other transit problems that you expect. The mission was excited for development, and based on the concept study report, not the proposal, the concept study report that is generated after the proposal has been accepted. The specific goals of the mission were basically the Kepler mission specifically designed to survey the extended zone of the Earth, detect and characterize hundreds of Earth signs and larger planets in the Kepler zone. And then you see the fact that we have to specify, we're talking about size distributions, orbit distributions. We're interested in planet-forming multiple star systems. We're quite aware that the Newman and I made a paper talking about half the stars are star, we're going to be binary. That we're interested in giant planets, and we needed other systems, other approaches to help us confirm the planet transit. Timing variations, rate of velocity, and a number of other methods. And finally, a major part of what we proposed was that we would survey the area of the stars that we're going to look at and classify those stars. Some 5 million stars, we'd rate them in around their group, what they did for us, so we could pick out appropriate target stars. The instrument is shown here basically as a wide field view Schmidt telescope, a corrector, a primary at the bottom. This is a large primary here. The electronics are prime focus with the detectors. The system is an F1.0 system operated at 1.5. And so there is no focal plane. There's a focal surface. And that shown here is quite curved. And the CCDs are flat, so we have to put lenses over the entire surface of the CCDs to make the images flat. You can also see little detectors here, the 4 CCDs at each 4 corners. They actually track the field of view and allow us to have the same star and the same pixel for months at a time. 0.01 arcseconds to resignal. A major component of the mission, a major component that allowed us to get accepted, was the public outreach program. The public outreach program consisted of an outreach to the public, an outreach to the scientific community. Outreach, all the different pieces there. That part was considered so good in our proposal that it was used as a parody for other discovery class missions. We had an outreach to the scientific community with a participant scientist program, a guest investigator program, and many of you participated in a guest investigator program and participated in a scientist program. That really enlarged the science that we could do. Again, another major component that made the mission successful was the science office operations. If you look at the top there, that's what our data actually looks like. And you can see every 3 months, there's a big break in the data. The variation of data may change over 3 months by 1%. And so you have to get rid of all that variability, take it out with the programs that are developed in the pixel, the planetary candidate system. And you can see that the raw data comes in, you calibrate the pixels, groups of pixels together to make a star. You look at that star very, the variation, the brightness of that star, and correct out the variations of one. You get a nice flat curve when you see that the fuzzy curve here. And then, of course, you can see the many, many transits here. There are several planets here. When you do that, you're talking about looking at 70,000 stars. And so it's really a very big process. Here's an example of what we do at the end of the mission. This would be 3 years into the mission. We've got some 18,000 threshold crossing events, things that might be systems of transit, but we don't know. And so it goes through a process of triage here, where you found 11,000 of these events really don't look like transits at all. 3,000 we've already found, so those are excluded. And we go down through this chain. To finally get here where we find new false positives and new candidates to observe. The observation, of course, is another major component of this mission that made it a success. On the upper left, you can see something we have to do with the data. That is, we look at the motion of an image during the transit. There are other stars around, so the image will move during the transit. And here we show that for this transit, this one, this one, this one, these fall very close to the target star, not near a nearby star. So this was a very powerful method of excluding nearby stars. Of course, radial velocity was a gold standard. And when we do radial velocity, we begin the same phase, the same period, we had a very good confirmation. Another method that was used was the Spitzer observations. Spitzer operates in infrared. We look at the visible with Kepler, and if the dips are the same, then it's the star, not the background star. The background star would almost certainly be redder, and we would see a much bigger dip with Spitzer. We take all this data and a lot of other data as well, and put that together and calculate the odds that this is a planet versus it's a false positive. And that is something that Francois and Willie did very, very well for us. Here's our data. Our data was a surprise in many ways. We found, well, the part that wasn't a surprise was that we found thousands of planets and planetary candidates. This is what we expected. This is what we proposed. So this part doesn't surprise us. What does surprise us is this huge number of planets in very transparent orbits, the fact that we see lots of planets bigger than Jupiter, and that we see this huge number of planets between the size of Earth and Neptune. Planets sizes that aren't representing ourselves. We do see a lot of Earth-sized planets, but we see this interesting hole here where it's easy to find large planets, but we don't find large planets, but just small planets in transparent orbits. An indication possibly that a migration plays an important role in planetary system formation. Very few planets that are Earth-sized for long periods, and that was another surprise. What we had predicted was that two-thirds of the stars like the Sun, being older than the Sun, would have less variability than the Sun. That is not what we found. We found most deep dwarfs were quite noisier than the Sun, which meant our signal resolution fell substantially, and so we didn't see as many Earth-sized planets around G2 dwarfs in the habitable zone that we hoped for. Another major component of this mission was the fact that people recognized pretty quickly that what you found was not necessarily a representation of what was out there. We have a sample distribution, not the parent distribution. If you look at the sample distribution, you see the number of planets, the occurrence rate of planets decreases as the planets get smaller. But there, obviously, small planets are much harder to find than big ones. So you have to compensate for the many, many biases that exist in this kind of survey. And Chris Burke did a crack at that, where he looked in 2014, and he found when he compensated for those, we see a very fast rise in the occurrence rate of planets as you get to smaller and smaller ones. If you add these three, you find that, in fact, there's an average of about one planet about Earth size per star. And that means, since there are between 100 and 300 billion planets in our galaxy, there must be at least 100 billion planets in our galaxy. Planetary surprises, certainly upper list almost. Here to the left is two planets with nearly identical orbits. One is a gas giant, a really nice giant, the other one is a rocky planet. And yet, that's not what we expected. We expected gas giants to be at large distances, rocky planet being close to their star. Again, it's indicating migration, planetary migration, there's planetary formation. The next thing, of course, is binary stars. In our mission, we predicted we could find planets around binary stars, and this is an example of such. The next planet there is a planet most frequently found, something between the size of the Earth and the size of Jupiter. In this one, in the habitable zone, if it's a water planet, possibly a water planet, it would have water on the surface, it would evaporate, we'd have a water atmosphere, vapor atmosphere. Nitrogen and CO2 are very common in our solar system. You might very well have an atmosphere that was conducive to plant life. Do we find planets in habitable zone? Yes, we certainly found dozens of planets in habitable zone. A huge variety of sizes. Few that are not as small as that of the Earth. Planetary systems. We expected, everybody expected, that the planetary system we would find would look like our planetary system. There were letters from the committee to the headquarters saying we didn't need to look for Earth. Jupiter's, finding Jupiter's at 12 AU after 12-year periods would prove there were Earths. That's not what we found. Many, or most of the planetary systems we found, are completely unlike our own solar system. Not that our own solar system is impossible, we haven't been able to do to characterize the Jupiter's, for example, at the larger orbits. One of the things I find most interesting in the planetary system is this one at Kepler 444. It's got five small planets close to a star, it's probably Borucki, and that means that star is some 6 billion years older than our own. That means right at the beginning of the galaxy, Borucki planets were being formed. If you lived there on those planets and you looked up at the nighttime sky, you wouldn't see the Milky Way. It didn't exist yet. It was being built. So from the beginning of our galaxy, Borucki planets have been built. And that means if any of those are habitable zone and life was formed, that life might be much more advanced than ours. Not by a thousand or a million or a billion years, but by a huge amount. So there may be some very interesting things to discover as we explore our galaxy. Conclusion, a 4-year conclusion from the Kepler mission, that we start with the Ames mission. A very brilliant engineers and people, Ball and Ames, worked out that all Kepler could no longer look at its field views of all two of the reaction rails. We could, however, look at lots of different field views along the ecliptic and do a lot of really, really interesting science. See, that Ames mission was put together, and what we see here are a huge number of papers coming out and all sorts of topics. Exoplanets, microlens, natural seismology, rocket archaeology, classical pulsators. There should be some young stars, some supernova and galactic objects. Supernova where you actually looked at it long, so long at the start, we actually saw the start of the shockwave. We saw the breakout in the shockwave of a supernova. So lots of great scientists there. The results, our results of this mission have certainly been noted by the community. What we have are a lot of team awards, and I'm going to show you some of them because right now these objects are in a glass case in building 200 in Ames. So if you ever get here, come take a look at those. I know many of you haven't seen them, so I thought I'd show them. We have the Robert H. Dyer Memorial Trophy, National Space Club. Laureates Award for Space and Aviation Week. Current achievement, Smithsonian National Air and Space Museum. A medal from AIAA. New Space Award. Vision to Reality. Very nice way of putting what this mission has been from something simple to something that has been producing a great deal of science from space to so you ask you all to clap because you were the people who actually got those awards. Okay, we need to finish up here. What is it that Jeffers found? What are the fundamental things that he's found? Not the details so much. Most stars have planets. We didn't know that. Planets have been forming from the beginning of our galaxy. We would not have guessed that. Earth-like planets are common. Planets unlike any in our solar system are also common. Planets of all sizes are found in the habitable zone. Other planetary systems are quite unlike our own. The implications of that are really profound. We know there are billions of planets in the habitable zone, billions of planets that are roughly Earth size. And yet the SETI program, that has looked for 3 decades, has not found any signals. What does it mean? Does it imply we haven't searched enough stars? Possibly. It could imply that our assumption that because you have a planet parallelism of a star and water, the life doesn't necessarily start. That may be a very probable event. It may be that life only evolves typically to the bacterial level, or to the level of single-cell organisms, or to non-technical civilizations like the North Dinosaur that ruled the world for 100 years. Or it evolves to technical civilizations, and they destroy themselves. We don't know, but we do know now for a fact that the Fermi paradox is real. There are a lot of planets out there in the habitable zone, and yet we've heard no signals. Something for us to look into in the future. It is our future, but certainly it's got a lot of missions. They're not testing online. We'll have the AOST shortly, but the first, the day of flying, chaos, and the New World Telescope, and other systems, which will allow us to actually look and see if there are miles of images around any of these stars.